The hydrological cycle. The hydrological cycle is basically the storage and flux of water on and under the earth's surface. Hydrological cycle excludes those pathways that take the water deep into the earth and back. So these pathways refer to the processes of subduction of tectonic plates, where the oceanic water is also a part of that subduction process, and this oceanic water moves deep into the mantle. Similarly, the water from within the mantle, from within the earth, is moving out to the surface at the mid-oceanic ridges and volcanoes in different parts of the world. So these two processes, these two pathways, that is the movement of water from the oceans into the mantle and the emergence of water from the mantle into the oceans or directly into the atmosphere in the volcanoes, this process is not a part of the hydrological cycle. Okay, so hydrological cycle is a closed system, because a closed system is one where there is an exchange of energy, but there is no exchange of matter. So if we look at the hydrological cycle, there is exchange of energy. Sunlight is coming and is falling on the surface of earth, and it is actually driving the hydrological cycle. But as far as the matter is concerned, and here the matter of concern is water, so the movement of water within the hydrological cycle is conservative, that is, it is neither created nor destroyed, but some water is lost out of the system and some water is gained into the system. But that I have already told, from the via the subduction process and from the mid-oceanic ridges and by the volcanoes. But this water is negligible as compared to the water that is stored in the different reservoirs of the hydrological cycle, and the flux of the water between these different reservoirs. So the third point is that in the hydrological cycle, water is stored in different reservoirs or different storages. I'm going to discuss this point shortly, and these reservoirs are connected by pathways or processes. So here is a depiction, is a conceptual depiction of storages. Here are two different storages, and these are connected by pathways or processes. So now let us discuss the different stores of water in the hydrological cycle, their relative volumes and the residence times of water in each store. The largest store of water on the planet is the ocean, followed by the water stored in snow and ice, which is all fresh, and the water that is present in the oceans, it is all saline. The snow and ice includes the seasonal snow cover, snow packs, alpine glaciers, ice caps and ice sheets. So snow and ice is followed by the groundwater, that is the water present below the water table, which is followed by permafrost, which is simply the frozen groundwater, followed by the water present in the lakes, and this is followed by the water present in the soil as soil moisture, followed by the water present in the atmosphere, and this is followed by the water present in the wetlands throughout the world, followed by rivers, and this is followed by the water present in the biomass, this is followed by the water present in the vegetation canopy. And there is another storage of water that is very transient in nature, that is the depression storage, and that forms due to the presence of irregularities on the surface, on the ground surface. This is also known as microtopography, and during rainfall events, these irregularities are filled with water that creates the depression storage. So now let us see the relative volumes of water that is present in each store and the residence time of water in each store. The oceans contain 96.5% of the total water present in the hydrological cycle, and the mean residence time of the water in the oceans is 4000 years. Snow and ice cover about 1.74% of the water, of the total water present in the hydrological cycle, and the residence time ranges from 1 month to approximately 6 months for snow, seasonal snow, and for snowpacks it may be about around 10 years, and for glaciers it ranges from 10 years to 100,000 years, and it can be even 1 million year, for example, for the East Antarctic ice sheet. Then coming to the groundwater, groundwater contains 1.7% of the total water in the hydrological cycle. Now if we see this volume, it is comparable to the water present in the different snow and ice reservoirs. But when we break up the groundwater into fresh and saline, then we find that the fresh groundwater is actually even less than 50% of the volume of water that is present in snow and ice. So fresh groundwater is just 0.76% of the total water in the hydrological cycle, and saline groundwater accounts for about 0.94% of the total water of the hydrological cycle, and the residence times range from 2 weeks to 10,000 years. So 2 weeks is for the water that recharges the ground and emerges at the local stream. So this circuit is very short, so in very small catchments the water can complete this circuit within few weeks. But if the water percolates or goes down into deeper parts of the aquifer, then it may take hundreds or thousands of years to come back to any surface water body or the ocean where it will discharge. After this, we have the permafrost, which contains about 0.022% of the water, total hydrological cycle water, and the residence time ranges from 50 to thousands of years. This is followed by the water that is present in the lakes. So the lakes account for about 0.013% of the total hydrological water. And of this, almost 50% is the fresh and 50% is saline. 0.007% is fresh and 0.006% is saline. And the mean residence time of water in lakes is 10 years. This is followed by the water present in soil, which account for 0.01% of the total hydrological water, and the residence time ranges from 2 weeks to 1 year. This is followed by the water present in the atmosphere, which is again 0.001%, appears similar to the water present in the soil, but actually the soil moisture on a global scale, soil moisture is slightly larger than the water present at any particular time in the atmosphere. This is followed by the water present in the wetlands, which constitute 0.0008%, and the residence time is 1 to 10 years, followed by the water present in the rivers, 0.0002%, the residence time is 2 weeks. This is followed by the water present in biomass, 0.0001%, residence time is 1 week. Now, what we can see here is that the ocean, the major part of the the main store of water in the hydrological cycle are the oceans, but this water is all saline, so it is not of direct use for the human beings. Then a large part of the water of the hydrological cycle is stored in the form of snow and ice. The seasonal snow cover melts to produce surface runoff, and that sustains the rivers and recharges the groundwater. But the water that is present in the glaciers, that is an immense quantity, and that may not be of any direct or any practical use by the human beings. This is followed by groundwater, and as already discussed, the fresh groundwater which is of use by the humans is only 0.76%. So if we compare the total fresh water, we can see that the most important source of fresh water is the groundwater, because this is practically usable or practically accessible by the human beings. Now let us come to the processes, the different pathways or the different processes that connect the different stores of water in the hydrological cycle. So because there is no starting point or there is no ending point of in the hydrological cycle, but considering the fact that oceans contain the maximum, the largest amount of water in the hydrological cycle, it is logical to begin from the oceans. So the oceanic water evaporates, and this evaporation accounts for almost 90% of the total evaporation that is taking place on the surface of Earth. The remaining 10% evaporation comes from the continental surfaces, from rivers, lakes and wetlands, and from the soil surfaces. Then the transpiration from plants, and evaporation and transpiration together constitute the evapotranspiration. Then the water in the atmosphere condenses, the water vapor in the atmosphere condenses, and cloud formation takes place. Precipitation occurs over the ocean as well as the continental surfaces. There are many forms of precipitation, but the most common are the rainfall and the snowfall. The snow accumulates on the surface of Earth as seasonal snow in snow packs, and if this snow continues to accumulate over the years, it leads to the formation of glaciers. The water stored in these snow and ice reservoirs, it is lost by the process of sublimation, that is the conversion of ice directly into vapors, and by the process of melting, whereby the meltwater is generated. Now the water that has fallen in the form of rain, this water may hit the ground surface directly where there is no vegetation, or this water may hit the vegetation canopy, and the initial part of this rainfall may be, or it will be, intercepted by the vegetation canopy, depending on the type of vegetation, the density of vegetation, and the intensity of rainfall. So this is the interception storage or the vegetation canopy storage. And then the water falls on the ground surface, and this water on the ground surface infiltrates into the soil, and this process is known as infiltration. If the rate of rainfall is higher than the rate of infiltration, then overland flow will be generated, and water will move down the slope of the surface. The water that has moved down into the soil, it may move down further, and this process is known as percolation. And if this water reaches the groundwater table, then it will be groundwater recharge. Sometimes the water within the soil profile may move laterally. I will discuss it later why this would happen. So this is known as interflow. The water that moves down will become part of the groundwater, and within the groundwater zone, the water moves to the nearest water body under the influence of hydraulic gradient. So when this groundwater flow emerges in surface water bodies like rivers, lakes and wetlands, this is known as base flow. The water within the rivers, lakes and wetlands may flow towards the oceans, and this is the continental runoff. In the coastal area, the sediment beneath the oceans contains saline groundwater, saline water, and on the continental side there is fresh water, and between these two water there is an interface that is known as the fresh water salt water interface. The fresh water, the fresh groundwater, tends to move out towards the ocean, and it discharges into the ocean in the coastal areas, and this discharge of groundwater to the oceans is known as submarine groundwater discharge. It is also known as subsea outflow, and this outflow takes place through an outflow face that is adjacent to the coastline. So now let us focus on this part of the hydrological cycle, where a lot of processes are taking place and that are generating different kinds of flows of water. We zoom into this part and we see that the vegetation or the interception storage, when this interception storage is full or it is saturated, the water starts to drip through the foliage. This is known as throughfall. The water may also move down through the stem, that is stem flow. Now this water that is falling to the ground, if it is a forested area or if it is a non-forested area, then the rainwater, the rainfall will directly hit the ground. Whatever is the case, once the water is on the ground surface, it will tend to infiltrate into the soil, that is infiltration, and it will become part of the soil storage. Now, if the rate of entry or rate of input of water to the surface, whether it is from the foliage or whether it is directly from the rainfall, if this rate is greater than the rate of infiltration, then of course surplus water will start accumulating on the surface and it will fill the depressions that are present on the surface, because land surface is never very smooth. It is always having some irregularities, that is known as micro topography. So we can see here there are depressions. So these depressions will be filled with the surface water, and this is the depression storage. Once these depressions are full, they will pass over their water to the lower depression, and in this way the overland flow will be generated. Now this kind of overland flow is known as infiltration excess overland flow, because here the limiting factor is the infiltration capacity of the soil. Now the water that has moved into the soil storage, this water may be taken up by the plant roots and it will become part of the biomass, and from there it will be lost to the atmosphere by transpiration. The water present in the soil storage may also move laterally through the soil, and this is possible because of the presence of soil macropores. Now these soil macropores are present in forested landscapes, because in a forested landscape a lot of animal activity is going on within the soil, and the plant roots, they decompose and they leave behind tubular spaces. Similarly, the burrowing activity of earthworms, of different insects and some mammals, this also leads to the formation of tubular openings within the soil profile. So all these different kinds of tubular openings, they are interconnected, and this leads to the formation of a very fast pathway, a potential path through which the water can move within the subsurface. So thus the water that has infiltrated, it may move laterally through the soil profile. This is known as the interflow. And if after the plant uptake and after the interflow there is surplus water is there in the soil, then it will tend to move downwards towards the groundwater, and then this process is known as percolation or groundwater recharge. In many landscapes there are low permeability layers that are differently named as hard pans or duricrus, and these may be present within the soil profile or they may be present within the vadose zone. So they prohibit the vertical movement of the soil water towards the groundwater. They inhibit and they promote the lateral movement of the water, of the vadose zone water, and this is known as through flow. Now all these different flows, the overland flows, interflow, through flow and groundwater flows, these flows are moving within the over the land, within the soil and within the groundwater. They tend to move to the nearby water body. So now let us focus on what is happening close to the river channel or close to a lake or any surface water body. Let us focus on this part of the water cycle. So here we can see that near a surface water body, that is river or lake, the interflow, that is the flow of water that was taking place within the soil profile, when this water comes into these lowland areas, low-lying areas, it tends to emerge to the surface. And this emergence of the subsurface water within the soil profile, this is known as the return flow. And whatever rain, if there is rainfall on this particular piece of land adjacent to the water bodies, then this rainfall will not infiltrate, obviously, because the water, the soil is already saturated here. And this rainfall will be, 100% of this rainfall will be converted into overland flow. Now this overland flow will be saturation excess, because here the limiting factor is not infiltration capacity. Here whatever water is delivered to the surface, that will be transformed into overland flow, because it cannot move into the soil profile. Plus the water that is coming from the soil, it also becomes part of the overland flow, and it is quickly delivered to the stream. And the groundwater is delivered to the stream or lake, and this is known as base flow. Base flow contrasts with quick flow. So for any particular river or lake hydrograph, if we develop, then there are two major components that are quick flow and base flow. Quick flow is all that water that is delivered to the river or lake or any water body very quickly. So this is quick flow is simply overland flow plus the interflow. And base flow is delayed flow, because the groundwater flow is slow. So in a river channel or in a lake, sometimes after the rainfall event, the water is delivered very quickly via the overland flow and return and interflow. But base flow sustains the river or the lake for a longer time after the rainfall event.